Thank you very much for the invitation, and it's a great pleasure to be here in such an authoritative place, which is also so friendly, and which we can discuss openly about several issues. I'm going to discuss the relationship between the dialogue between civilizations, which of course we strongly endorse here, as opposite as a clash of civilizations, through the methods to do that. And the method which I'm going to discuss is what a few colleagues and I have suggested several years ago at the end of the Cold War, namely cosmopolitan democracy. We know what were the hopes of the time. Sorry, I don't have the command, the remote control. The hopes were, of course, oh, thank you very much. My God, you see, the Cardinal, thank you very much for taking care of everything. That's the origin of our hopes, you know? I mean, when the Berlin Wall fell over, we had hoped that the Cold War was going to end and that new expectations could be opened. This was not something only in the North, it was something which affected the South when, for example, Mandela was elected president of South Africa. And indeed, in many countries of the world, we experienced a ritual of freedom and democracy, free elections. And indeed, it's quite significant to see that precisely in 1990, the number of countries lured through elected governments started to become larger than the number which was where the government was not appointed through elected government. And if you would like to see it in a map, that's how it looks now. That was indeed good news, very good news, but not enough. It was not enough because there was the assumption, sponsored by many colleagues in international relations theory in the United States and other countries, that to achieve a just and peaceful world order, it was enough to operate through the internal lever, as if the international society, a democratic international society, would have emerged simply by adding one democratic state after another. And that's unfortunately was not the case, and we declared it. And after that, we have seen terrible wars in Iraq, for example. We have seen that Afghanistan, after more than 20 years of military occupation, has not sorted one single problem of its troubled story. And again, we see again destruction, warfare, human rights violations in Ukraine. And so, what went wrong? What went wrong? And that's, I think, the issue that we need to discuss it. And in our approach, we try to connect I can call the internal and external lever. On the one hand, we have got the idea that the more you increase the number of democratic states, the more you get a democratic global governance. And that's possibly true. But it's not enough. There is another component, which is to try to make a global governance system with more participation, more players, and not just the governments of states, and where a non-domination and dialogue is becoming more important than imposition. And on this side, unfortunately, we have failed. And that perhaps explains why the hopes of the 1990s were not capitalized in the global society. So we discussed a multipolar world. Well, what does it mean, multipolar world? Are we happy to imagine a multipolar world just because we are not dominated by one single lonely superpower, or because there are two or more superpowers? That's, I think, is a very traditional way to understand the multipolar world. It means that we still continue to consider that states are the main and perhaps the only players in international affairs. And this is something which comes from the past. This is something which is not going to sort out the problems. When we see a war between Ukraine and Russia, which doesn't even remember the Second World War, is more similar to the First World War, in which people are killing themselves on a destroyed territory in a society which has internet communication, connections, interactions. Indeed, that reminds me very much, since we have got one of our hosts is from Buenos Aires, what another person from Buenos Aires said, Luis Borges, commenting the Falkland War between Argentina and the United Kingdom. He said it looks very much like two bold people fighting for a comb. And that's indeed, besides the tragedy of the war in Ukraine and Russia, what are they fighting for? When frontiers might become irrelevant, when two states which are close by historical legacy are willing to cooperate as the United States and Canada, as Argentina and Uruguay, as Belgium and the Netherlands, as Germany and Austria. And therefore, here there is something wrong, something rotten, perhaps because we are still thinking in terms of states as the only players of international society. So we have to break this. We have to break it, and this is precisely, sorry if I do a spot, what we try to do in the program Cosmopolitan Democracy, a program which has quite a variety of applications with more people working, some of them on the technical issues, applying, for example, network analysis to look at how there are connections across states, or they're working on the legal dimensions, or they're working on international relations side. And of course, Jeffrey, none of us is a realist. Why is needed? Because any form of global governance will be always very weak unless we increase the participation. We have seen it in very specific areas of activity. Take the case of response to vaccines for COVID-19. It was quite clear that each state was thinking about itself, and that was not sorting a problem which was global. Likewise, as is often repeated in this room, the environmental crisis, climate change, is a typical case which shows that there are overlapping communities of faith, and no individual state can by itself manage to achieve the goals. Indeed, the states are still those which have the majority of resources in their hands, of course, so we cannot do without states, and we are not interested in doing without them, but there is something which should be mobilized, looking for new resources and new capabilities. For this reason, I would like to urge our colleagues that a proper dialogue among civilizations will need also a different institutional empowerment. How can this be done? Well, sometimes something has happened. It was remembered, for example, that the International Criminal Court should also be responsible for ecological crimes. I would like to remember that the International Criminal Court was created because there was a strong commitment by some governments, including the Italian government. And let me say, if I remember my youth about that, we had to link with the foreign affairs ministers. And as you may know, in Italy, governments do not last very long. And in a few years, we had to link with an enormous amount of different ministers. And that was a bipartisan commitment. The Italian government, together with the Canadian government, managed to lead a coalition of states which led in 1998 to the creation of the International Criminal Court, and the treaty was signed here in Rome, by the way, in the Campidoglio. Of course, this is not sufficient, but is an indication that you can create some forms of state buildings which go beyond nation states. This, of course, will imply to give more power to the already existing international organizations. I mentioned the COVID-19. It is incredible how weak the World Health Organization was now compared to how strong it could be in the past. Back in 1971, the World Health, at the peak of the Cold War and of the rivalry between the United States and Soviet Union, the World Health Organization managed to launch a successful program for the eradication of smallpox, in which vaccines were administered in all countries of the world, including developing countries, and indeed 50 years ago, the capabilities, the medical infrastructure of these countries, or many of these countries, were much worse than now. They managed to do that. It has, and therefore, we wonder, in a period in which the World Health Organization was every day on the news, how come that the governments were not willing to devote more resources and more capabilities to an organization which involves governments, of course, but involves also the medical expertise in a variety of different countries, and therefore was not something done or in which the governments were participating, but were participating a large number of expertise across countries. It has already been mentioned the UN Citizen Assembly. This is another proposal on which we are very keen, which has a large variety of activities. What does it mean? It means that parliaments are necessary, I repeat, for everybody. Parliaments are necessary in order to be dialogues. Parliaments are not just about voting, are not just about majorities and minorities, even if at a certain point majorities and minorities are important for decision making. Parliaments are a way in which different positions can be listened, can be heard, can be confronted, criticized, and so on, with transparency and publicity. We have managed to do something in the European Parliament. We are the European Parliament, which has very little power, but still is an important tribune in which Europeans can discuss their issues. Even Farage, the leader of the Brexit movement in the United Kingdom, was a member of the European Parliament, and he could talk there. And therefore, something similar can be done also at the world level, in which different citizens of different countries may discuss their views and develop the subject of this meeting, namely a dialogue among civilizations. Thank you very much.